Good data is hard to come by, and APIs hiding behind paywalls asking for obnoxious amounts of money doesn't help us developers in the slightest. But it's not like anything changes. Data is still required for almost any modern task. As AI and ML models skyrocket in popularity, so does the need for good data. The only options we really have to get our hands on large amounts of data are paying for APIs or manually gathering the data yourself. Those methods work, but if you want data from a service that doesn't have an API, you're basically out of luck. Unless you want to feel like a hacker. And let's be real, who doesn't? The secret is web scraping. Alright, it may not be as close to hacking as you'd expect, but it's still really cool. Web scraping is essentially extracting and harvesting data from websites by searching through layers of HTML. It's as simple as locating divs or other tags and uncovering data within them. It's pretty neat, and you can do a lot with it, but you also have to worry about CAPTCHAs, because websites don't enjoy bots. And then there's also IP blocking as a way to get you to stop snooping through the site, and also browser fingerprinting, dealing with cookies, setting the right headers, and it just turns into a hassle. That's where Brightdata, the sponsor of today's video, comes in handy. Brightdata has a tool called the Scraping Browser that runs on their proxy network, allowing us to scrape the web with no concerns of being IP banned. It can also solve CAPTCHAs, handle automatic retries, select the right headers and cookies, and just about anything that a traditional web scraping bot would fail at. Modern websites are adapting to bot detection quicker than ever, and a tool like the Scraping Browser is extremely useful, if not a must, to web scrape at an industrial scale. There's a ton of different tools that Brightdata offers, however, the Scraping Browser is perfect for developers, as you get complete control over your workflow. In our case, we're going to connect the Scraping Browser with a tool from Google called Puppeteer. Puppeteer is a headless Chrome browser that you can control and interact with through JavaScript. Puppeteer also allows us to programmatically click buttons, fill out forms, and basically do anything else a person can do. With the combination of both the Scraping Browser and Puppeteer, we can collect data from any website without any worry of being stopped in our tracks, caught red-handed with a wild web scraper. In this video, we'll go over how to scrape data from websites by gathering comments on Reddit regarding people's opinions on stocks. We'll then take this data and perform sentiment analysis on it with the NLTK library in Python to see what the general sentiment of the market is on any given day. To start off, we need to install the Puppeteer core library. We can install core instead of the full Puppeteer, as we only need the headless component, since we're going to connect to our remote browser. We can then create a JavaScript file, but before you write any code, we need to create the scraping browser on the Brightdata website. You can get there by following the link in the description. Once we have our browser set up, we can access all of our authorization data in the Access Parameters tab. To make our life even easier, there's already some boilerplate code that we can use as a starter for the scraper. In order to find the right tags and information related to the data, we have to look through the source code of the website. Utilizing inspect element is extremely useful here, as Puppeteer's dollar methods are equivalent to document.querySelector. In this case, we'll look through Reddit's old site rather than their newer one, as the tags and class names are more verbose and don't look like randomly generated IDs. The basic workflow is to find the last couple daily discussion posts and go to them. Once we're inside, we click the Show More Comments button to load all possible comments. With all the comments loaded, we can extract data like the comment body, upvotes, and others. Like I mentioned earlier, taking advantage of inspect element makes it much easier to ensure that we're finding the right selectors. Inside the post with all the comments, we click the Show More Comments button through Puppeteer and wait for the new content to be populated. To actually get the list of all the comments, we can wait for them to load in and then select them, skipping the first and last because those aren't comments. If you're wondering why we even select the first and last elements if they aren't comments, it's because web scraping is scrappy by nature, and sometimes you need workarounds and methods to get the data as we need it. We can wait for each selector using the waitForSelector method that allows us to make sure a selector is present, which stops us from trying to find a selector that doesn't exist. In order to get more information, we can map over the comment containers and extract the comment bodies, upvotes, and time of posting. With each of the items, we do have to perform some level of data cleaning, otherwise our data would turn out like this, rather than this. Since we perform an async map, we need to wait on all the promises at the end to access the data. The last line just writes all of our data to a JSON file. With the complete dataset, the possibilities are endless. You could analyze trends, see what people are thinking, automate systems, and the list goes on and on. In our example, I'm going to use NLTK's Vader tool to perform sentiment analysis on the data. I chose to use Vader as it was already pre-trained on social media data, which is perfect for this. It's surprisingly easy to use the library, and with just a couple of lines, we can get the sentiments of each comment. The first thing to do is to download the Vader lexicon, because without it, Vader would have no idea what anything means. Then, we convert the data from our JSON format into a pandas data frame. In general, whenever I work with data in Python, it's much easier to deal with it in NumPy or pandas because of their wide range of features. The star of the show is the Sentiment Intensity Analyzer's Polarity Scores method. It gives us a dictionary of negative, neutral, and positive scores between 0 and 1. It also outputs a compound score, which is the overall sentiment from negative 1 to 1. With all the data in a data frame, it's far easier to manipulate it into a more consumable form. To find the overall sentiment, we can take the sentiment for each of the comments and multiply it by the number of upvotes the comment has. We do this because the way I look at it, each upvote is just another person agreeing with the comment, meaning that the sentiment is shared by more than just the comment's author. For a better visual, we can plot the data, and interestingly, most of the comments have a neutral sentiment. Upon further analysis, the Vader tool isn't always the most accurate. For example, the comment, "Whether you are a bull or bear, using analyst projections 7 years out is stupid. They can't be trusted at all more than a year or so out," had an overwhelmingly neutral sentiment, and moreover, had roughly the same negative and positive sentiment scores. Obviously, as a human, we can see that this comment is more negative than positive. However, that's an oversight to the computer. While Vader works fine in a pinch, it is something to take note of. ChatGPT, for example, correctly tagged the sentiment as negative, showing that every model treats data differently. Regardless of how we classify sentiment, we can use this information in many ways. If the sentiment is negative for a couple of days, it shows that people are a bit worried about the market, and stocks could be more volatile. On the other hand, if sentiment is positive, it could show that people are excited about the way the market is trending, and that it could be on an upward path. Like I mentioned in the beginning, good data is hard to get, but with web scraping, the entire internet is at your fingertips, allowing you to do just about anything you want. That's all I have for today. I'll see you guys next time.